Hi everyone, welcome back to Vintage. Thanks to everybody who left comments last week, lots and lots and lots of you, which is very, very encouraging. Because as I said, I'm a big Roth fan. I would love more people to read him, and I'd love to be able to talk to more people about him. So great to see lots of you who had read him, others who were interested, and others who, you know, just wanted to win pretty books, which is fine too. I did have four copies of Roth to give away, a little mini Roth library. And the lucky person winning that is Memento Mori. So congratulations. You will find my email address at the bottom of this video's description. Send me your postal address and I'll get those books off to you as soon as I can. For those of you who are interested in reading Roth but aren't maybe sure where to start with him, there is an article on our website where I and some other Roth fans in the building have sort of suggested a book which might be a good place for you to start. There's a few to choose from and you can find the one that sort of best fits with you. You'll find a link to that down below too. How are you all doing? It's been a funny week, hasn't it, with everything that's sort of going on in the world. And so that's why I'm going to talk about the book I'm going to talk about today. But also just to mention that this weekend that's just gone, we held a live recording of the Vintage podcast. If you don't know, Vintage has a podcast. You must know that. It's a good podcast. I host it along with Alex Clark, and we have at least one a month. We're going to be doing more than that next year. And this past Sunday, as I said, we were in an amazing place called Spirit Land in King's Cross, which is a sort of bar restaurant with an amazing sort of audiophile sound system in it so that you can hear incredible music with these amazing speakers that are bigger than I am. We had an all-day event there to celebrate the publication of Murakami's Absolutely on Music. We were talking about Haruki Murakami all throughout the day, talking about his various books and publishing him and his connection with music and all that kind of stuff. And it occurred to me that in these troubled times, if what you're looking for is not so much the sort of politically engaged writing of somebody like Philip Roth, but something far more escapist, something to really kind of help you forget about what's going on in the world, Murakami is perfect for that. I mean, so, so perfect. We talked about several of his books that we thought were perfect for all sorts of reasons. But again, down below you will find a link to that latest podcast. I've managed to sort of edit a whole day down to about 40 minutes, but I'll be releasing the full chats from those days into a separate podcast because they were much, much longer and really, really fascinating. So we've got sort of, you know, his publishers, his designers, the pianist James Rhodes, and another musician, Jeremy Walmsley. Fantastic. It was a brilliant, brilliant day. So yeah, if you need an escape, I would really, really recommend that. Now, why am I waffling on so much before talking about this book that I'm going to talk about? Well, because continuing the 2016 Classics Challenge, I have a book that was actually mentioned by somebody in the comments here. Tom Cooney mentioned it when I was doing one of my other Classics Challenges. And he recommended this book here, The Man Who Planted Trees by Jean Giono, which is published by Harville Secker in this really, really pretty hardback edition, which has got illustrations by Harry Brockway. It's got an intro from Richard Mabey. And I actually had it on my list of books to read this year, partly because, as you can see, it's very, very short. It is just a matter of pages. I'm going to count. It's like 30 pages. That's about it. It's probably not even that. You can read it in 30 minutes. It's a perfect lunchtime book if you wanted something to read in your lunch break. And the reason why I'm waffling on so much about other things is because there's very little I can say about this book without sort of giving the whole thing away. So in fact, what I'm going to tell you instead is the sort of background to its publication. So Jean Giono was sort of approached by Reader's Digest, who were running a series of pieces which were entitled The Most Extraordinary Person I Met. And he loved a commission, and so he went upstairs and wrote this relatively quickly and submitted it to Reader's Digest, and they loved it. But then a few weeks later, he received a very angry letter from them in which they said that they had discovered that actually this thing that he had written about the most extraordinary person he'd ever met wasn't true, actually, because they'd done some research, and the person that he describes in this book hadn't actually died in the hospital that he said he died in the place that he said he died in the year that he said he died in. And that was because, of course, Jean Giono was a fiction writer. He'd made it up. But it was so convincing as a piece of writing. It's so immediately accessible and believable that when they read it, they presumed what he'd written was a piece of non-fiction. And they were very upset to discover that it was just a piece of made-up story. Anyway, It never got published, but then, of course, it kind of did get published, and it got published and translated and went around the world and has become a miniature classic. And that is because The Man Who Planted Trees is about that. It's about a man who plants trees. I really don't want to say any more about what happens in it, except to say that it's sort of a fable which is all about the difference that one person can make on the world. And also the fact that there is a positive impact that we as humans can have on the world. At the moment, it can feel like that's not the case so much. It can feel a little bit negative. And generally speaking, when we look around the world and we see footage from war zones and things like that, it can feel like our only impact on this planet is one of destruction. And I think in particular, when we think about something like climate change, or we think about pollution in the seas or whatever it might be, along those lines, that certainly feels like a very destructive impact that humans have on the planet on which we live. So in many ways, this book, written a long time ago, is sort of a precursor to that ecological literature and the idea of being green and the idea of ecology being important to human beings. And that's why I think it's really fascinating, because, as I say, the overwhelmingly positive message from this book is that it is entirely possible for us to do good, it is entirely possible for us to bring life where there is none, and it is entirely possible for us to reverse the damaging effect that we might be having. And if that isn't a good and positive message to be reading right now, I don't know what is. And that's why I wanted to talk about this book this week. It is a really beautiful, as I said, hardback edition, which has got some illustrations in it as well. And I have two copies of it to give away this week. So if you are interested, please make sure you are subscribed, leave a comment below, and I will pick two winners next week. And big thanks to Tom Cooney as well for giving me the prod required to read this book, because I really loved it. And as I say, right now, very good read. So there we go. That is that. I will be back next week with more exciting things. There's going to be a few midweek vlogs coming up, because I've been filming with graphic novelists and other YouTubers. So watch your notifications, because there will be more than just the Friday vlogs in the lead up to Christmas. I'm trying to give you early presents. Do you see what I mean? I'm sending out love. Anyway, thanks for joining me this week, and I'll see you next week. Take care.